Yes, our desire is that God will rain upon us and break the yoke so that we can become his free people. I am very pleased to say good evening to you. Ah, a little bit better than that by way of response. Good evening to you.
Evening.
That is better. In case you don't know it, my name is Jumem Noelist. Now, I shall not ask you to repeat that. This is an assignment I give to my students as I begin teaching, and they will flunk the course if they don't repeat it well. And it is my privilege to serve as the director of the Vernon Grounds Institute of Public Ethics. And it is my privilege to welcome you at the Rally for the Common Good 2016. Yes, this is Rally for the Common Good 2016. The Rally for the Common Good is part of the annual program of the Vernon Grounds Center for Public Ethics, a ministry, an initiative of our dear seminary, Denver Seminary. And I'm very proud that the seminary has taken that initiative years ago. Each year, the Institute selects an ethical issue of very high social significance for scrutiny. These are not easy issues, but we think this is precisely what our faith calls for. Our faith is a living faith, and it's a relevant faith. There is nothing in life that our faith cannot address. So we come together tonight to continue our exploration of the theme of focus for the year, namely, how, as Christians, we can confront the legacy of racism that has been bequeathed to us and which continues to haunt us. It is my hope that as we gather together here in this place of worship, and as we listen and share together, we will find something to take home with us, something to help us chip away at this monster. That's what it is, in our respective circle of influence. As we worship together, as we listen, and as we share, let us open our hearts and our minds and, yes, our wills, and allow the Spirit of God to have his way on us and in us. Before I take my seat, let me just draw attention to some resources that we have in the foyer. These are monographs that the Institute publishes every year on the theme that it explores. They are not going to make us wealthy. They are only for $5 contribution each. So as you leave, take a copy and go with it. May God bless us all. Amen.
This time I want to take a moment to invite Dr. Danny Carroll to come to the podium. And before this man comes, I just want to let him know, I don't get a chance to do this much, how much I appreciate you. He has really formed me and shaped me when I was a student at Denver Seminary with his Old Testament class. Particularly when we got to Job, I had a completely different appreciation for the tension and the stuff that we wrestle with this whole issue of race. I almost didn't like him because he was on my MDiv committee when I was graduating. And this guy said to me in the middle of orals, when we were in class, there was a Hebrew word for Satan. Do you remember what it was? And I'm sitting there, you're kidding me. You know? And I just want to let you know, I love you. love you, man. You're going to forever be in my life. You have shaped me. You've become a great friend, and I'm glad to call you colleague. Dr. Carol, come on up. Yeah, lead us. Yeah.
I'm supposed to read the scripture, not be introduced like that, but thank you. What he didn't tell you, which was a wonderful thing to be a part of, is that when he finished his MDiv oral, he was weeping. And it was such a joy, because you were just so happy to finish. And that didn't come out right. No, but as a professor, that moment really meant a lot to me, even though it came out all wrong, right? But, yeah. Thanks. This morning there was a passage that was mentioned but not read, and so tonight what I'd like to do is to read that passage. It's in Colossians chapter 3, and I'm going to read the first 14 verses. Paul says this: "Since then you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, which is idolatry. And because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in those ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger." This is so appropriate in this whole discussion. "Anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you've taken off your old self with its practices, and you've put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people," and this is where the reading, I think, lands for us, "holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other," which is what we need to do with this reconciliation. "Bear with each other and forgive one another," which is where we're going tonight. "If any of you has a grievance against another," if any of you has a grievance against someone, "forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds us all together and binds all of these in perfect unity." Let's pray. Father, we sing and we clap and we rejoice because we are Christians. And this country has centuries of a legacy and an actual practice of something that violates the very heart of your being. We are all made in your image. We all stand equal before the Creator, and we should stand equal before one another. Give us the patience and the forbearance and the grace we need to move ahead as a reconciled body of Christ. May your Spirit, as we have sung, be poured out on us tonight. May we show the world that in this room things are different. Not easy, not forgotten, but different. May you be pleased with us, and may your Son be glorified and exalted by all we say and do tonight. For we ask it in his name, the crucified and resurrected one. Amen.
Thank you so much for allowing me to be with you this evening. I'm going to read my comments tonight, if I may. And if you ever invite me to preach in your church, I promise to let go. But tonight, I think it's important. What I have to say is serious enough. I'd like to read these comments, if I could. I'm going to ask some of my colleagues to join me on the stage, if I could, board members and faculty members who've come and joined us tonight. By way of an introduction to what I'm going to read, I'd like to maybe provide some context for you. In June of last year, I invited Brandon Washington, Pastor Brandon Washington, and Pastor Felix Gilbert to make a presentation to the trustees of Denver Seminary about the disturbing, tragic events that were occurring in 2014-2015, the events that brought racism in our society into sharper focus for many of us. In particular, I asked them to reflect with us on the difference between the two communities viewed those events, and particularly on the relationship between the seminary and the Black community in Denver. At that meeting, the trustees approved the formation of a race relations working group to explore the idea of making a formal statement about the tension that had developed and persisted between the seminary and many in the African-American church. Members of that group included our trustees Eddie Broussard, Ted Travis, Patricia Rabin, and Brian Wilkerson. Our student, Pastor Brandon Washington, was on that group, as well as the Director of Urban Initiative, Felix Gilbert, and I was a part of it. What follows is a reflection, a personal reflection, and a prayer that has come out of my own personal journey of learning and growing and a growing concern about racism and my participation in it. This reflection has been crafted with the help of my brothers and sisters in that group, and many other African-American friends, authors, and leaders. It is by no means a perfect document, or perhaps not even significant. It is raw, and it's personal. And like its author, deeply, deeply flawed. It is honest. I have read this document to the trustees and to the faculty of Denver Seminary, and both of them have voted unanimously to endorse its sentiment and its substance. And it is entitled Racism, A Reflection and a Prayer. So here we go. Just 2 weeks after becoming the president of Denver Seminary in the summer of 2009, I had the privilege of meeting with a group of African-American church leaders in the city. Even in that first conversation, it became clear to me that an undercurrent of tension existed between the seminary and many in the Black community. Unfortunately, that tension has remained, sometimes more obvious than at other times, but always simmering beneath the surface. Efforts on both sides intended to bring about resolutions seemed not only ineffective, but sometimes even seemed to aggravate the problem. This tension has confounded and befuddled me and grieved me. A couple of years ago, an African-American friend asked, "Mark, are you a racist?" His question stunned me. I didn't know how to answer, and I didn't do so for what felt like an eternity to me anyway. Finally, I heard my voice saying, "I don't think so." That was a beginning. That question has haunted me ever since he posed it to me. The series of very public tragedies in 2014 and 2015 that resulted in the deaths of African Americans at the hands of police officers roiled our nation and raised troubling questions about systemic racism. Even more troubling to me were the different narratives and interpretations of these events that emerged in the Black and white communities. Generally speaking, the white narrative interpreted these events as stories of individual actions, While many of my African-American friends saw them as evidences of systemic, racially driven injustice. How could these two communities, even in the church, hold such divergent views of what had happened? Then came the massacre in the Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina. A white man sat at the table with the people of God, tasted their hospitality, and murdered 9 of them simply because they were black. Naked racism, pure evil, assaulted the sensibilities of our nation. While grieving that tragedy, another troubling question emerged in my heart and mind. Whereas it was easy to see the mass murder in Charleston as racially motivated, why was it harder for me as a white man to see all of the other events as such? And that question kept ringing in my ears, "Mark, are you a racist?" Like many, I have defined racism individualistically. This approach allowed me to assume that since I didn't have negative or prejudicial feelings toward African Americans and hadn't therefore intentionally sought to disadvantage them, I wasn't a racist. It also allowed me to remain ignorant of the history of racism in America and blind to its tenacious and pernicious presence in contemporary U.S. society. I can't think that way anymore. Several books, articles, and conversations have begun to chip away at my ignorance and indifference. Aha moments, troubling questions, and painful realizations have been my companions along the way. I'm not yet far enough along to speak with any measure of confidence on these matters, but some key learnings have reshaped my thinking. First, seeing racism as more of a multidimensional social reality than an individual prejudice has helped alleviate my tendency to see it as someone else's problem and thus ignore it. In their book, Divided by Faith, Evangelical Religion and the Problem of Race in America, authors Michael Emerson and Christian Smith propose the phrase racialized society as a starting point to better understand the problem of racism. They write that a racialized society is, quote, a society wherein race matters profoundly for differences in life experiences, life opportunities, and social relationships. Professor Robin DiAngelo, writing as a white American, understands racism as, quote, a system that ensures an unequal distribution of resources between racial groups. Second key learning for me. Because whites have more power in all of the significant social institutions in U.S. society, we benefit from a racialized society and fail to recognize that fact in our own sense of accomplishment and success. Quite frankly, I seldom think of the influence of race or racism in my own life. As a result, we too quickly and too easily deny that racism remains a social reality that negatively affects the lives of millions of people. A third key learning for me. Many of us in the white community are uncomfortable talking about race and racism because it challenges that detachment from racial issues. DiAngelo writes this, quote, we move through a racialized world with an unracialized identity. Challenges to this identity become highly stressful and even intolerable. We perceive any attempt to connect us to the system of racism as unsettling and unfair, even a moral offense. Fourth, most of us, myself included, most of us are unwilling to admit that we have chosen to live segregated lives in the places we reside, work, play, worship, and send our kids to school. We make these choices as an expression of deeply held values of comfort, security, and opportunity, yet we seldom, if ever, would admit that the choice to live segregated lives may come from deeply buried desires to live apart from blacks. In living segregated lives, we live impoverished lives, and we communicate that we see little intrinsic value in building relationships, deep and abiding relationships with African Americans. Fifth, because we do not see ourselves as part of the problem of racism, and because we do not recognize how pervasive and destructive its ongoing presence is to our society, we do not readily engage in actions that prophetically rebuke racial inequality and racist behavior. Our silence makes us tacit supporters of a racialized society and complicit in its perpetuation. And then there's always that question in ringing in my ears, Mark, are you a racist? Coming face to face with my complicity in supporting a racialized society has turned me inside out. The realization that I have benefited from a social and economic system that has been built through a shameful history of racially driven segregation, oppression, and injustice, even though I may not have intentionally perpetrated such acts, has challenged my sense of identity, my narrative of personal accomplishment, and the shallowness of my faith. At times, it has felt as if the sky was falling, but it didn't. What is falling, however, is my willingness to deny, to explain away, and to be indifferent to the scourge of racism. As I struggled to express my thoughts and feelings in this journey, Patricia Rabin, a Denver Seminary trustee and a member of the Race Relations Working Group, recommended that I write them out as if I were speaking with God. What emerged from that advice is a prayer of lament, repentance, and commitment. And so here is that prayer. Have mercy on me, O Lord. I have blinded my eyes. In spite of the clear evidence of deeply embedded racism all around me, I have looked the other way. Too many have suffered. Too many have been locked out and cast aside. Too many indignities, too many injustices, and still, I looked the other way. Have mercy on me, O Lord. I have hardened my heart, believing the lie that blacks have the same opportunities as whites. I could not allow myself to admit that my life was shaped as much by racism as theirs, mine to benefit and theirs to harm. But it was and it is and it will continue to be. I have cared too little. I have grieved too little. Have mercy on me, O Lord. I have silenced my tongue. My voice has not been raised in prophetic rebuke and anger. My feet have not stepped out for justice alongside those who have more courage than I do. And in my silence, I am an accomplice to bigotry. Forgive me, O Lord. I have sinned against you and against those who suffer the evil of racism. Indifference has smothered my soul. I ask for your forgiveness, and I will appropriately seek their forgiveness as well. Empower me, O Lord. I need your strength to step beyond blindness, indifference, and fear, to step toward those whom I have sinned against. I make no grandiose promises or plans today, for I know how easily these can be made and forgotten. But this I know, I cannot be the same, and I will not. Amen. This is my prayer. I have shared it with the trustees and the faculty of Denver Seminary, and I humbly share it with you today. As I said, they have stood with me and endorsed this prayer and this sentiment fully. I do not presume to make it the prayer of others, but I can say that as the president of this school, it reflects my heart to lead Denver Seminary to a new place in our relationship with the African American community. I ask for your patience, forbearance, and willingness to speak truth to me in love when I fall short of its sentiment and substance. And I ask for your help in bringing resolution to a tension that has lingered far too long between us. May the Lord help us in that quest.
Amen. Dr. Young had an opportunity to share with some of the black students on campus, and I will say after he shared, it was just a spiritual moment being part of the faculty. When he shared the statement with the faculty, we had a very humble foot washing experience that God really moved and had his way. This time we're going to have three respondents. One of our students, the leader of our Black Student Fellowship, Pastor Brandon Washington, is going to respond. It's going to be followed by Pastor Dale from the Greater Denver Ministerial Alliance. And then Michelle's going to come, and they're just going to share their hearts in response to what they heard this evening. Bless you, man. Bless you.
I had prepared something. And then after hearing Dr. Young's heart, I decided to leave it in my seat. And some of the people in the room know me. Some of you are members of my church, so you're concerned now. But I do believe this is obedience. Denver Seminary is my seminary. Now, I want you to hear me in saying what I intend to say. I don't want you to hear the words of an impetuous four-year-old who is battling another four-year-old over a toy. I'm not saying it is my possession. I'm saying that it is mine relationally, in the way that my wife is mine, and my children are mine, and my church is mine. Denver Seminary is my seminary. I didn't realize that until recently when I found out that Dr. Carroll is leaving. Yeah. And he may have even noticed this. I was avoiding him because I was not responding to that in a manner that was familiar to me. It was an emotional response that was foreign to me. It was irrational, and I'm extremely, probably sinfully, rational. And I realized after thinking about it that it's because Dr. Carroll's departure is not me struggling with change, it is me struggling with loss. Because Dr. Carroll is my Dr. Carroll. And I love him because while taking an Old Testament class, he told me that my commitment to social justice is not merely a good idea, it is not merely an option, but it is my biblical imperative. I will never read the book of Amos the same. And when I processed that, I realized that while his was the most prominent and loud voice, his was not the only one. Dr. Nolise taught me about theological ethics, and I'm a better man for having taken it. Dr. Chung introduced me to a heart for evangelicalism. Drs. Blumberg, Mathewson, and Elodie Emick introduced me to reading the New Testament intentionally through the lenses of its writers. Dr. Payne made me fall passionately in love with a deep understanding, a new understanding for me of sanctification. They are my, relationally my, professors. Well, the reason that's a struggle for me is while I was willing to say that Denver Seminary is mine, while she is mine, my time at Denver Seminary did not always give me the feeling that I am hers. It felt like an unrequited affection. And with that came struggle and hurt and anger and loneliness. And in the midst of that, Pastor Felix shows up and says he wants me to be involved in Black Student Fellowship. And my response to him is, no, I'm just here to get this degree done so I can get out of here. And he said, no, I want you to speak into some of the change that's coming. And I said, I really don't think that that change that you're referring to is likely. And he challenged me, and he took me to Dr. McFarland's office. And I felt, listen to me, I felt heard. There is a huge cultural presumption. I'm not telling you that I was merely heard. I felt heard. After that meeting, I had a meeting with Dr. Young, and in that meeting, I felt heard. And then he modeled it by inviting us to speak to the board about those very issues. And in that room, I felt heard. And he made a commitment privately to us that you are now witnessing publicly. He first revealed this public commitment to the Black Student Fellowship, and I saw transparency. I saw heartache. I saw genuine tears. He was not handling me. This was a man who was genuinely hurt because people who sit under his leadership were hurt. We felt heard. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Let me tell you about today. Today I witnessed a man stand in front of me and say, I hear you. Before you and God's people and God himself, I hear you. And it will not be the same. That is what I heard you say today. And because I heard you say that, I want to repent in your presence because I have publicly disregarded you. I have publicly disassociated myself. I want to not only receive an apology well, but I want to give one well.
That was very powerful. This is a very powerful opportunity tonight. I'm Pastor Dell Phillips. Currently, I happen to hold the office as the president of the Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance. Before I make my comments, I need to be clear that I've never been a student at Denver Seminary. I personally have never had an altercation, a conflict, let alone an experience that made me feel that I was racially, I was being treated inequitably because of my race. I personally have had none of those experiences. But I am aware that there has been, and there currently exists, a disconnect between the Denver Seminary organization and the African American community, and particularly members who are part of the organization where I serve, who have at some point in time been a staff person, an instructor, or perhaps even a student. So I come not to speak on behalf of Dell Phillips. I also don't want to imply that the Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance can speak on behalf of the entire African American community. Amen. Because quiet as it's kept, you know, we are not, don't all look alike. Amen. And we don't all think alike. We don't all live the same life. Amen. So I'm not trying to posture and say this is on behalf of all black people in the state of Colorado. So let me stay in my lane. I'm representing our organization, who has had encounters with Denver Seminary. Brandon, I sense the same thing. I kind of had an idea what I was gonna say. Now I'm not as, you know, proficient as you. I didn't write that down anyway, so it wasn't as hard for me to discard as yours, because it wasn't written down anyway. But I did have a thought. Until I heard the scripture that you shared, and Brandon, you referenced this same word. In the fourth chapter, I believe the 26th verse of the book of Ephesians, the Bible says to be angry and sin not. This is one of the few places in the Bible where we are actually given permission as believers to exercise a negative emotion, where we are given biblical scriptural permission to exercise what I truly feel in a situation and not to suppress it. One of the few places, and I know I'm talking to seminarians and theologians and folks who are much greater scholars than I am, so I know I don't have to translate this, but, you know, it's not often in Scripture where we are given the instruction to actually exercise that negative emotion that you are feeling, and don't try to deny it. Anger, in its definition, means to provoke or to be provoked. And African Americans who are part of the Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance have great reasons for being angry, for feeling like we've been provoked, because all we wanted to do was to acquire an education. And we thought that it wouldn't make a difference what ethnicity I am, if I simply want to learn from the same book, not a different book, from the same professor, not a special professor. I don't want to go to the special people's class. I didn't ride the short bus. I came in my own car. So I simply want the same education. And let's don't forget, I'm not getting a discount. Come on, somebody, amen. Okay, don't play, amen. I'm not the only one on financial aid. Come on. I'm not asking for something extraordinary. I want the ordinary. So it's very provocative to discover that in that circumstance, I'm being treated differently. To have men or women who have come to serve in leadership capacity at Denver Seminary only to discover that their degree, for some reason, does not measure up to someone from another culture who acquired the same degree, and so they're not given the same kind of teaching privileges, or when they are given the opportunity, those opportunities are short-lived. Those are the provoking things that have made us angry. And we have a right to be angry. But there's the other part of the scripture. God's giving us permission to be angry. But then it says, but sin not. Now, this is where I did have to pretend that I was a seminarian, go really discover the root word of sin, because we have so many opinions of what sin is. And sin is not as much a specific deed of what you do or don't do as we have manufactured it to be. You know, it's not that you drink and you smoke and that you hang out in places that you shouldn't be in. That's not really the essence of what sin is. In that Greek definition, it says something very simple. The Greek word harmatia means to miss the mark. So don't be so angry, black folks from the Greater Metro Denver Ministerial Alliance. Don't be so provoked, even by just cause, that we miss the mark. Because there's something greater at stake here. And this is why I can accept, on behalf of our organization, your apology and the litany of what you have shared that you know needs to change in this organization, is because we don't want to miss the mark. There is something greater at stake here than just my personal infraction or just another person's omission of what they should have done. We don't want to miss the mark. So I want to close with that. That's more important than anything. Don't miss the mark. Maybe it's good that this came at a time when your president's name is. Mark Young. We need someone who is willing to join with us to hit the mark. We need someone who is willing to put past policy aside and to embrace present progression so that we can all hit the mark and not miss the mark. So I got to give you this short list first. So we have an expectation. This is a very important gesture here tonight. But I don't think anybody in the room would leave here thinking that we just resolved all the racist issues tonight from one statement and one prayer. Come on, somebody, amen. That's, we have to, I said we don't want to miss the mark, amen. So you got to know what we're chasing after. You have to understand what our objective is. So I need to give a quick little list here. So we receive and we accept Dr. Mark Young, this apology, this lament, this prayer. And for us to not miss the mark, we need to make sure that we remedy as quickly as possible the necessity for having African-American professors that come from our community. Amen. Folks that we know because they have a degree, even from your institution. Amen. that should be qualified to teach on staff, to have tenure so that they don't have to worry if they're going to be unplugged or disconnected if something doesn't go a certain way in the classroom. We're needing that to be a part of the objective. We need a part of this objective to hit the mark, to make sure that there is no disparity, not just among color, but even among gender. I believe we have progressed enough to understand that there should be no disassociation between the men that want to enroll and the women that want to enroll. Anybody that's still wrestling with that question and that issue hasn't read the entire scripture to understand that God has no distinction when it comes to gender. And then we want to make sure that there is support for all the students. And carefully hear what I just said, all the students. The things that we're asking for, I was very clear. We're not asking for something extraordinary. We don't want black teachers for black students. Come on, somebody, amen. Do you understand where I'm going with this? We want black teachers because I think you said you're missing something when it comes to teaching the gospel. If you don't hear it from a black instructor's point of view, it's real hard to embrace the totality of the compassionate message of Jesus Christ if you've never had to physically, literally live and walk in those conditions. So we bring something to the classroom. We're not asking for something extraordinary. We simply want the ordinary. Just like you have white teachers, we want black teachers. We want black teachers teaching white students. We want white teachers teaching black students. We want the ordinary. And when it comes to support, be it mentoring support, financial support, we don't want a special black people's fund. Amen. Same money, be it from federal or from private institutions that provide the finances for this institution to support students, we are asking for the same fair share to be dispersed among all the student population. I want to be clear. We're not asking for the extraordinary. The mark is just let's simply hit the ordinary. And when it's all said and done, I close with this. The only thing that should be peculiar about us is how we are able to get along. What should make us peculiar people is that black, white, and brown can go to the same classroom, can go to the same institution, can walk the same hallways and not have any interference. That's what the Bible is talking about when we are a chosen and a peculiar people, a people who are not limited by their measurement of a person's standard, their color, their ethnicity, their background, what kind of house they live in, what kind of car they drive. We should be that peculiar people who are representing to the rest of the world that we are all God's people. No matter what neighborhood we come from, we all belong to Him. God bless you.
So I'm not going to go rogue. I'm going to read what I prepared as well. Up until tonight, I didn't hear what Dr. Young had said, so my response is not a response to his lament, but it is a response to the conversation that we've had today and to today. I want to take the opportunity to thank Denver Seminary for creating space to bring us together to talk about this vital issue. Today is a good day, but it is only one day in which we have come together to talk about race and the deep and necessary work that is to be done to overcome our racist legacy. During my brief time allotted, I do not want to talk about today. I want to talk about tomorrow and the whole hosts of tomorrows that are before us, so we can ensure that all of this talking that we've been doing actually does something. As a Christian, we recognize that talk must take on action. We know because we follow the one who called himself the talk, the word. He became flesh and he did something. He brought good news to the poor, the fullest expression of his love and his death and resurrection, providing us a way to be reconciled to him. In that reconciliation and the fulfillment of his promise, we in turn were given what we needed to be reconciled to each other. Now, when I speak of reconciliation, make no mistake that I am not talking about representation. Representation on our church staff, in our institutions, and in our society is not reconciliation. We as Christ followers need to move beyond representation and its limited effort. To be reconciled is to bear one another's pain and burdens and make them our own. To be reconciled is to courageously and boldly say that Black lives matter, both to us and to God. This theological statement rooted in the Imago Dei declares that all people are divinely endowed as image bearers of the Creator. Over the course of our nation's history, we have deemed Black life as criminal, inferior, and subhuman. I believe that in stating Black lives matter, we declare that the lives of those who have been rendered the least of these matter. As a person of privilege, whose perspective has been radically changed because of my proximity and the ability to live in communities of color, I implore us to lean into true agape love. We as Christians know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. We must love with action and with truth. We also cannot only elect to engage with those impacted by racial bigotry when we can relate on some type of level, when hate makes its way into the church and kills people gathered for prayer, but also, when an African-American mother's son wearing a hoodie is shot and killed by a civilian. When a father must grieve the death of his son whose crime was music that was considered too loud. And when an unarmed Black man is shot in the back while running from where he was pulled over for a traffic stop. And when a man is choked to death whispering, "I can't breathe." Those are the tomorrows that will test this moment. While the waters are still muddied, and we may not know the details, but what is the church going to do? We know what to do. We have been told what to do. Above all, brothers and sisters, we must love deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. And I'm not talking about that sin in the moment or whether you feel responsible for our racist legacy or not. I am talking about the sins that go back generations and beyond, where humanity and privilege began to name what was and was not valuable, bringing us to this destructive place, a siloed church separated by fear and the lie that we cannot be one. Brothers and sisters, agape love, perfect love, sacrificial love drives out fear. My brothers and sisters, do not leave this day and move in tomorrow with the same guarded, complicit, fearful response to the pain of the body of Christ. But instead, take this moment to commit to lean into our collective tomorrows with sacrificial love that will build bridges to the shared pain of those who are hurting. It is not noble to stay on the sidelines. It is not noble to remain silent. It is not noble not to pick a side. Greater love has no one than this, than to sacrifice his life, his reputation, his privilege for his friend.
Before we pray, if we can all stand together and let's just join hands as a symbol of what God is doing tonight. Dr. Van Ark, one of our trustees, is going to lead us in a time of prayer. Amen. Bless God.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think it's time to pray. Our great, eternal, and gracious God, we come before you in lament. We come before you with repentance. We come before you with love. God, we have so glibly sung, we are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. God, we realize that we cannot be one with you if we cannot be one with each other. So, Lord, our prayer tonight is, help us begin in the process of restoration, for we would be one in the Lord. We want to be unity, but Lord, we have sinned. And our prayer is, dwell in us, O Holy Spirit. Make us one. Make us love. Teach us to love our neighbors as we love you. God, we need your help. We pledge that we will do our best to become one. Please bless us this night. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This is a great moment, I'm sure you would agree with me. It is a great opportunity to share in what is not just a chronological time, but a kairos moment. We are going to move on with our program. There are also going to be a video. I am instructed that this will not take place, and we're going to now be prepared to hear the word of God. We are very honored to have with us this evening Dr. Crawford Lawrence of Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Lawrence is the senior pastor of the Fellowship Bible Church in Roosevelt, Georgia. He's a veteran evangelist with Campus Crusade for Christ, and has ministered widely throughout the United States and abroad as conference speaker, preacher, and lecturer. He's the author of many books and has been awarded honorary doctorates from some leading evangelical institutions, including Biola University, Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, and Columbia International University. Dr. Lawrence is married for 45 years. And he's the father of 4 children and 10 grandchildren. Dr. Lawrence, come and bless our hearts this morning.
Thank you so very much. I got to tell you, I'm struggling a little bit this evening. Sometimes the Spirit of God is doing something in the service, and you need to pay attention to that. You need to marinate in it. And one of the things I say at our church is that we make too many segues too quickly. We're too quick to move on to the next thing. And I don't know the implications of all of what's taking place tonight, and just where things will be. We have heard a lot of content, a lot of messages that had the Spirit of God's signature all over it. I really loved your dissection of that Ephesians 4 passage. I really love that. And so what I'm struggling with is that I don't want to give another content dump that would take us in a different direction. But we need to marinate in what has taken place. I'm old enough to realize that transformation begins by the point of repentance, but is sustained by the process of repentance. That's the reality of it. 1 John chapter 1, that is the emphasis there. If we confess our sins, that's the point of repentance. But if we walk in the light as he's in the light, that's the process of it all. And I say that to say that what we need to do is make sure that we're sufficiently sobered by what God has said, that it's loud enough in our souls that we do not go back away from it. That it becomes a historic benchmark in terms of where we need to be. Sometimes too much talking, we can talk ourselves right away from the conviction of the Spirit of God. And we need the discipline of silence and to think and to meditate deeply as to what does this mean for me moving forward. Forgive my rambling here, but I sense that, you know, we sang a lot of songs to begin with. They talk about a revival and let it fall on me. And we sing all of these songs. I wonder, do we really know what it means to be caught up in the flow of the Spirit of God? The price that needs to be paid for deep-seated, true repentance. I happen to believe that we've spent too much time speaking of racism in purely sociological terms. And please hear me on this. Please hear me on this. I don't want to be misunderstood. And we've spoken too much of it in terms of rehearsing the pain and the hurt that we have gone through. Now, it's real, it's deep, it's profound. And you're looking at a guy, I know my family tree. My great-grandfather Peter was a slave. My dad remembered him and the stories and all that went on. I get that. But there is a certain paralyzing element that when you marinate in something that is true but doesn't move you to the ultimate truth, you begin to stay where you are. Rather than experiencing the freedom of the Spirit of God to take you to where we need to be and where we ought to be. Memory should motivate transformation. Memory should not keep us stuck. Pain should move us toward healing. It should not cause us to cultivate the pain. That's the path to bitterness, and that's the path to boundaries between us. You look at what has not been done, you face it squarely in order to see the cross and the hope, in order to transform what has not been done to the new reality. These are the things that we need to think about, the substantive things that we need to think about. And one of the great problems that we have as a church living in our culture, and I said it this morning, the painful reality is that the evangelical wing of the church typically is 15 to 20 years behind the times. Because we've not engaged in the culture. We don't feel as other people feel, and we don't need anybody else in order to be successful. And so we have this false sense of security, and we can affirm ourselves because we've got the money, we've got the resources, we've got the skills, we've got the ideas. And yet we're injecting ourselves with an embalming fluid of carnality. And we may be missing God's opportunity for the greatest revival in history. And I am so moved by Dr. Young. I'm so moved by you, my brother. And all movements of the Spirit of God begins with repentance. Doesn't begin with worship songs. I love worship songs. But it begins with repentance. Not my mother, not my father, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. And that's where we need to begin. I'm not going to be long tonight. There are three texts of Scripture that I want to leave with you this evening. Actually, four. The fourth is the application. I'm going to tell you this quick story. Dr. Norlist said that Karen and I will celebrate our 45th wedding anniversary next month. We were only five when we got married. And yeah, it's the joy of my life. And we do have four kids and 10 grandkids. Love our grandkids. Love our children too, but really love our grandkids. We grown folks bring drama, don't they? We got this three-day rule around our house. They can come. The parents can come for 3 days. Now, the grandkids can stay as long as they want. The parents can come for 3 days. See, if God could raise Jesus in 3 days, you can get up out of my house in 3 days. So that's just three-day rule. Amen. Bless you. You start getting sick of each other on the fourth day. So. But let me tell you how I met my wife. I'm going someplace with this. Honestly, I am, and hopefully it does relate here. I had broken up with my high school sweetheart and came back to college to begin my sophomore year in college. And this is a true story. My high school sweetheart, we were in love. Not love, love, L-U-V. It was deep. And but she kicked me to the curb. Can you imagine? Can you imagine somebody getting rid of this? But yeah, you're saying, actually, I can. She got rid of me. And so this is a true story. I was on my knees in my dorm room praying. Lord, no more women. They mess you up every time. And, I was saying, I'm not going to date anybody this semester. I'm going to be pouring myself into my Bible, into you, Jesus, and my struggle studies, just you and me, Jesus, like this. I'm hurting, and, I need time to heal and all this. People who know me know that I can be fairly focused once my mind is made up. So I get up off my knees, and I was walking down the street to the main administration building, and my mind filled with this deep, stalwart, single-minded, focused prayer not to be distracted or deterred in any way. None whatsoever. Nothing matters but Jesus. And get to the main administration building, still rehearsing this prayer, throw open the doors, and there at the top of the stairs are these two brown legs. And I said, Lord, what have we here? I learned a very important lesson. Never make foolish vows. God had a divine hookup. And so, and those legs belong to Karen, my wife now, but she was new on campus, and my mama taught me to be hospitable to strangers, and I introduced myself. But one of the things that Karen and I have learned, here's where I'm going with this. One of the things that Karen and I have learned over these many years that we've been married is that the depth of your intimacy in marriage is in direct relationship to the sacrifices that you make for each other. You determine the depth of the relationship. But the relationship is not cheap. It's expensive. Great marriages are not kept together by feelings of love. Great marriages are sustained and kept together by a commitment to love. I'm going someplace with this. There's too much superficiality, too much conditional love passed off as agape love among Christians. And one of the reasons why we struggle with unity in the body of Christ is because we fail to realize that unity is extraordinarily expensive. There cannot be unity apart from sacrifice. Unity is more than holding hands and saying prayers or exchanging preachers or choirs or showing up for stuff or this kind of thing. The hard work of unity is what we saw tonight. It is brothers and sisters who are coming together and we create safe places. We say, we ain't running from you. You're different color than I am. You got a different background than I do. You come from a different place than I've come from. But we've fallen at the foot of the cross, and Jesus has forgiven us of our sins, and he's washed us clean. And so culture A, when it comes to Christ, and culture B comes to Christ, it doesn't create culture C. When culture A comes to Christ, it creates A primed. And when culture B comes to Christ, it creates B primed. And it's that prime position that sits in judgment over everything that we have. And we fight for the prime position because we want our lives and our relationships to tell the truth about the gospel. And that's where the hard work comes. Where we don't run from each other, but we run toward each other. There are just a couple of texts of scripture that I want to point you to. The heart of Jesus is given to us in John chapter 17. This is the heart of our Savior. Now, mind you, he's praying this prayer, the emotional context of the text. And I always get on these homiletic professors. It drives me crazy. When you teach exposition, you teach people to preach, tell them not only to honor the historical grammatical context, but the emotional context of the text. The emotional context here. The emotional context. Jesus is facing the cross. He's going to cry out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? The sins of the world would be placed on him. All of the sins. He's gathered his disciples together, and he's summarizing 3.5 years of his earthly ministry in John chapters 13, 14, 15, and 16. They're celebrating with him the last Passover, which is nothing more than his own wake. And now we come to this prayer in John 17. And what does he pray for? What does he pray for? John 17, beginning of verse 20, he says, I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. Just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them. Don't miss these words. That they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and you in me. That they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Oh, righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Let's summarize this paragraph with these two amazing implications. The heart of Jesus, obviously, is unity. Not a cheap unity, but an extraordinarily expensive unity. And this unity reflects the relationship Jesus enjoys with the Father. And when God's people, wherever we come from, reflect this expensive unity, we tell the truth about our relationship with God. Jesus prayed that I want them to reflect this relationship. I want them to reflect what we enjoy. Just as the Trinity, we heard a marvelous presentation this morning, the inter-Trinitarian love, the inter-Trinitarian community. And by the way, in the creation mandate, the only reason why God created family, when he said, let us make man in our image, he wanted us to enjoy the same community that the Trinity enjoys. And what the world longs for is to see that taste of unity that represents the truth of the Godhead. And also he says that this kind of unity reflects the glory of God to a watching world. He says that when they come together, they see our glory. The glory of the Father. We are his redemptive prize. And that's the heart of our Savior. And he weeps over our racism. He weeps over the barriers that we have set with one another. How we have prostituted the name of the Lord Jesus with our isolation and our segregation. And we've justified that nonsense. The second text is that there is evidence of our salvation. The evidence of our salvation is reflected in the love that we have for one another. John puts it this way in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. These are some strong words. He says in verse 7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. The key is this, understanding that if we don't love, we don't have the nature of God in us. And the word love here is the word agape. It's an extraordinary love, and we've trivialized agape in our desire to explain it and help our students understand it. We say, you know, phileo is brother love, and eros is erotic love, and agape is unconditional love. Well, I would argue that it's unconditional love, but on the other hand, trying to define agape is akin to trying to define holiness. Come on, Whitney. The human mind cannot begin to fathom the proactive purity of God. There's a built-in disconnect. It's kind of like trying to describe or define glory. How do you articulate the manifest presence of God? What words in your vocabulary do you have to articulate the presence of the Holy God? So it is with agape. Agape is part of his nature. It is not just unconditional love, but it's a love that ran you down when you were going in the other direction. It is a love that does unusual, abnormal, supernatural things through you. It's a love that says you have no excuse. You've got to run toward reconciliation because the nature of God is in you. So if you don't love, and if you're consistently isolated, John says you probably don't know God. I didn't care what you know about your theology, your rare Greek verbs, your insights, and I don't care anything about that. If there is not the manifestation of extraordinary love in your relationships, you probably don't know God. In verses 9 and 10, he further describes this love as being characterized by sacrifice. Yeah, yeah. This is the implication of the text. John is saying, no, we draw our bead on relationships, not by best practices among our friends. We draw our bead on relationships by the perfect Savior himself. And thus he says here in verses 9 and 10, he says, in this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation or the satisfaction for our sin. Connected in its context here, what he's talking about, he's not talking about one-off in our understanding soteriology here, but what he's talking about is the severe price that Jesus paid to demonstrate the love of God. And that he was the sacrificial lamb. And if you love one another, then you're going to have to be willing to be walked on, hurt, abused, manipulated, and used. It's got quiet up in here now. This is grown folks Christianity here. This is not entertainment Christianity. This is not, a little breath mint Christianity. But John says, look, if you want to be authentic, you want to live out what the Savior said in John 17 and be the answer to that prayer, then love is going to be characterized by sacrifice. What are you willing to crucify relationally to demonstrate this love? Who are you allowing to tell you who your friend should be? You give in to ethnic peer pressure. Oh, we have it. Yeah, we do. You afraid to be called a sellout? And Uncle Tom, betraying your heritage. When Jesus hung on the cross, he was naked. And part of the demonstration of agape means to embrace humiliation for the sake of the honor and glory of God, if I have to. Because it's not a matter of me losing my dignity, because I'm not looking to people to give me dignity. Dignity is not something you give me. Dignity is what I was born with. My dignity comes from God. So in that sense, I am free to sacrifice, because your approval, your acceptance, or your denial doesn't change anything in terms of my relationship with him. What are we willing to do? And then he says here that love also reveals the existence of God. Verses 11 and 12, he says, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. There's an ellipsis in this verse, though. When he says no one has ever seen God, the implication is that they will see him when they see you love in extraordinary ways. They will see him. And that's the raising of your hands and the dancing and the papers and the books and the all the kind of stuff. But they will see him. When I walk with somebody that's different from me. And they move toward my brother and my sister. And I won't let them go. Because Jesus didn't let me go. You'll start seeing God. And then the last one is this. So the heart of Jesus is unity. Love is the evidence of salvation. Love and unity are together. But this also is the mark of the disciple. Back in John 13, they're still at Upper Room Discourse, Jesus is with his disciples. And as I said, John 13 through 16, in my view, is Jesus summarizing everything that he taught his disciples in principle form. And you come to John 13, verse 34, and he says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. I remember many years ago, I was confused by this statement, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. If you know your Bible, love is not a new commandment. It had been demonstrated in the Old Testament, described and assumed that we would reflect chesed, God's loving compassion. So what does he mean by a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another? You know, if you keep reading scripture, it becomes its own commentary because he identifies what he means by that. He says, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples. Oh, that's what he meant by new commandment. By this shall all men know that you're my disciple. In other words, love now is a distinguishing mark of every true follower of Jesus Christ. It's not your correct theology, although that's wonderful and good and very vital and important. It's not our Christian cliches, but it's the price that we're willing to pay. Love. 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 I said this morning that, and I don't know, it's because I'm getting older and tired of taking laps around Mount Sinai with so many of these issues. You keep, looping around and still talking about the same thing. And you go to these conferences long enough, still see some of the same people going to the same conferences. I don't think it's cynicism, and I don't think it's, hopefully it's a holy impatience. I actually believe that we know the solution to racism. Now, no, I'm not being simplistic here. There are convoluted stuff and there's complex problems. I get it. Yes. But I actually believe that the solution is not difficult. What is difficult is the will. Now that's what's hard. That's what's difficult. It's not a matter. If we have the Spirit of God living inside of us, and if we're listening to the Spirit of God, he came to convict us of sin. We may not be able to always articulate things, but there's that little, we know when something's wrong. That's not right. We cannot move forward in solving these problems and articulating the solutions to them we can't move forward unless there is a commitment to two things. One is to say, Lord God, I will do whatever it takes, no matter what you tell me, to conquer this thing. I will do it. And the second thing is, I can't do it in the energy of my flesh. See, at its core, racism is diabolical sin. At its core, it is the demonic stronghold of the Western world. And I'm not one of these dudes that find demons behind every door. But the agent of transformation is the Spirit of the living God. And the third person of the Trinity lives inside of us. And the power to overcome, and the power to conquer these things, and the power to take a stand, and the power to speak up, Black Lives Matter, and the power to articulate, and the power to change, and the power to engage, and the power to keep pursuing, is not found in our strength, but it's found in the Spirit of the living God. Thus the Apostle Paul tells the Galatians in Galatians 5, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the desires of the flesh. He goes on to say that the fruit of the Spirit is love, and that's agape. The fruit of the Spirit is love. That fruit comes through yieldedness. It comes through transformation. And so I happen to believe this evening all of us need to surrender our hearts and lives to the indwelling power of the Spirit of God. And I am praying that in my lifetime, I will see a revival that will be born out by the Spirit of God that will specifically target racism and do a work in the church. For too long, we have been lagging behind the times. For too long, we have not been the moral example that God has called us to be. For too long, we've not been the vision of the ultimate destination at which the society should arrive. For too long, we were not intended to be lagging behind, but to lead society. For too long. Too long. So when are we going to say, Lord Jesus, take my life and let it be. Help me. I want your Spirit to tear down every stronghold of my heart and life. Life is but a brief moment in history, lodged between two vast eternities. And every day of our lives, we got to decide, what am I doing with this moment? At any moment, God can say, give me back my breath. Why are you here? Holy Father, we pray in the name of your Son that you will help us. We've heard an awful lot tonight, and we do need help. Father, all of us need to fall on our faces before you. There's sinful stuff and crap in our lives that we have compartmentalized. All of us get seduced into these terrible, toxic attitudes and thoughts. We get so accustomed to sin that we don't even realize that we're sinning. I pray that you'll make us sensitive to one another. We pray, Spirit of the living God, that you will cause our hearts to be soft and responsive. We pray that you'll forgive us as your people for being morally and spiritually lazy. God help us, the fires have gone out in our hearts. We have become more excited about the trappings of ministry and the stuff around ministry, and we have fallen in love with what we do for you more than we love you. And the people that come in contact with us. Lord Jesus, will you give us a breakthrough? Not only here in Denver, my hometown in Atlanta, Chicago, Dallas, Los Angeles, San Francisco. Will you blow up our privatized Christianity? Will you cause us to celebrate one another as never before? Yes. Will you give us the courage, Lord, to establish relationships with people that we don't live with, that we don't choose to hang with, but because it is right to do? Show us, Father. Help us, we pray. May we not, Lord, repeat and repackage the garbage that we're seeing now in this presidential primary season with all of the vitriol and nonsense and gaming and posturing. Lord, deliver us from that. Show us how to be the people of God, we pray. We love you, Lord, and thank you for yourself, and help us. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.